How about the Masters? Scottie Scheffler winning his second green jacket in the last 3 years, and the legendary Vern Lundquist calling his 40th and final Masters.
Who actually watches golf?
Welcome back to the Westfield Sports Show. We are your hosts, Rowan and Adrian.
This week we have an extremely stacked lineup of spring sports, a Pacers playoff preview, NFL draft talk, and much more.
Yeah, let's begin the show with baseball. They recently had a conference series against Brownsburg.
Game one was played despite rain and cold weather playing a factor. Ty Anderson gave up a run in the first, but this would be the only one he would give up all night.
Westfield immediately countered with a Drew Law triple, a Braden Hibler RBI, and then Alex Rudolph drove in one. Westfield led 2-1 after one.
Westfield was dominating on the pitching end, but then Alex Rudolph struck again, driving in three. Ty Anderson would eventually reach 10 strikeouts and was on a tear.
Yeah, then the sixth inning came and Braden Hibler did the unthinkable and hits an inside the park home run. He looked exhausted afterwards, and I really don't blame him. Here's my call of the week.
Phillips, that one hit into center field. Right center going back, and the catch is not made, and it goes to the warning track. Farrow makes it home. Hibler going for third base. Gets there. Is he going for an inside the park home run? The throw to home is not in time. Braden Hibler, an inside the park home run.
Detail is finally back, and here's Braden to talk about this incredible play.
All right, Braden, I want to talk about that inside the park home run from last Thursday. Just what was going through your head after you hit that ball?
I was like, dang, dude, I thought it was for sure a flyout, and then all of a sudden I was like, oh, we got wind today. So when I noticed the wind was blowing it, and it just took it all the way from center field to right, I was like, all right, we got a shot for, you know, a triple here easy. And then saw Bennett waving his arm around, and I'm like, no way, we're getting a little league home run right here. And I took off, I started running down third towards home, and I was like, all right, I look where the ball is, I'm like, all right, they're not getting me, this is easy. I slide in and I realize I cut my hip back open, so after the home run it was kind of like, ow, it wasn't worth getting a home run, but it was a cool moment for me.
I mean, were you exhausted after that?
Definitely wasn't like, I feel like I could, you know, keep going and running, obviously, but obviously you're a little tired after the home run. It's a lot of bases, a lot of feet to cover, so I was a little tired for sure.
And then finally, coming up this weekend, big series against Fishers, a conference series. I mean, does your mindset really change going into a conference series compared to any other?
The only thing that changes is really like how competitive our team's going to be and how like mentally locked in we're going to be. Like Carmel, obviously a big game for us. But when conference rolls around, we get locked in a different way. So we can continue to like be mentally tough in those situations.
All right. Thank you, Braden.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Braden. The Shamrocks took game one 8-1, and game two was at Brownsburg. And this time it was Preston Tam on the mound. He was striking out batters, but again, he kept walking batters and walked four, and he gave up a home run.
Tam was pulled in the third as Brownsburg led 3-2 at this point. Nathan Bodenberg came in for him and gave up a home run.
The sixth inning was huge for Westfield, kind of like the last game. Matt Droslik was driving in runs left and right, and Westfield had their 11th inning all year with three or more runs in an inning, and that propelled the Rocks to a 9-5 victory.
Here's Coach Bunnell to talk about the week ahead.
Hey Coach, I have to ask you about the Carmel game. Just in your opinion, what went wrong in the seventh inning and in extras?
Yeah, that's a good question. What did go wrong? The big thing is we had too many free bases. I think we walked eight in the last two innings. We got two big double plays to get us out of them, and that normally, double plays are inning crushers, but to Carmel's credit, they kept fighting and scrapped and found a way. They had some timely hitting, and it was one of those games. We left 12 runners on base, We had only had two walks up until the seventh inning, and then the wheels just kind of fell off. We lost the zone, and you know, then we didn't have that cushion that we could have had if we had not left 12 runners on base and gotten the big hit. And so that happens in baseball sometimes. So we're just kind of trying to take away the things that we have to from it. Like, we can't give the free bases, and you know, we got to have that timely hitting. But outside of that, you just try to move on as quick as possible.
Yeah, and like, you as a coach, after a heartbreaking loss like that, what is your approach in, you know, talking to the team?
Yeah, well, you know, our message was just that, you know, every time you lose, right, it's an opportunity to kind of learn what, you know, led into that so that you can avoid it for the future. So we try to look at it as an opportunity to grow. And there are good losses and bad losses. And we just told them, you know, this is it's really in their hands to make sure this is a good loss, one that we learn from and we grow from, not a bad loss.
Yeah, and finally, upcoming conference series going up against Fishers. Fisher is a team, a lot of great talent, but just how do you feel? I mean, after a loss like that, just what's the approach now going into a big conference series?
Well, we emphasized coming out and having a good practice yesterday, which we didn't really accomplish. So we put it back on them. We've got practice tonight and do that. So you just trying to, I think you get back to basics after something like that, and you try to be very fundamental. Just clean your game up and have a lot of energy and stay positive. You know, one game doesn't change who we are as a team. And so you just try not to put too much weight on it. Like I said, you take away the things that you have to be able to grow, to do your best to ensure that that doesn't happen again. And then you forge on.
Yeah, thank you, Coach.
You bet.
Yeah, thank you, Coach. And on the Monday before this episode comes out, they take on the Greyhounds of Carmel. Here's that score, and on the release date of this episode, they travel to Fishers, and this Friday, they host Fishers.
Now to softball. The girls started the season 5-0, but they have since lost their last two. Last Saturday against Cathedral was a game that could have gone in the Shamrocks' direction, but that's sadly not the case.
Yeah, Westfield jumped out to a 3-0 lead very early on, due in large part to Chloe Tanner, who was pitching and hitting. She would finish the day with two RBIs, but sadly, Westfield would go scoreless until the fifth inning, and Cathedral was on fire, and they took a 4-3 lead.
Shamrocks tacked on three runs into the fifth. Sydney Jordan was on fire with two RBIs, and Westfield led 6-4, until Cathedral tied it in the bottom of the fifth. Sadly, Cathedral was just too much in the sixth, as they put up two runs, and Cathedral takes this one 8-6.
Yep, this week, the Lady Rocks take on New Pal the Monday before this episode comes out. Here is that score. And the next day, they hosted Fishers. Here is that score. And on Friday, they will compete in the Kokomo Tourney, starting with Caston at 7:30. Let's talk boys golf and the prestigious Don Dickin Classic. The Rocks are reigning Don Dickin Classic champions. So let's see what happens here.
Clark Schwartz saves par on hole 4 with this beauty. Then the freshman, Braden Worthington, makes a birdie on the second hole of the day.
The young blood getting it done. But then how about Cohen Steele here with a beauty of a par save? But last summer, I have a story. I worked in golf course agronomy, and Cohen was out there all the time. And as a matter of fact, it was either him or one of his friends. They hit a ball, went right over my head, hit the tree behind me.
That's crazy.
It was crazy.
Jake Caesar with a birdie on hole 17, and your Rocks repeat as Don Dickin's champions. The green team finished first with a score of 298, and gold was right behind them with 302.
Yeah, Jake Caesar had a score of 71, which was tied for third individually.
They compete this Saturday at 8 a.m. at the Spring Showcase. Let's talk about the Tennis Delta invite.
Yeah, the Rocks were undefeated going into this, and for a quick spoiler, they continued that. The Rocks win the Delta invite and advance to 5-0. Isabella Norris, Addie Coy, Bree Saylor, Bella Rivera, Jenna Berry, Carly Lekowiak, and Juliette Grilliot all picked up wins.
Monday, they competed at Harrison. Here's that score. And today, in terms of episode timeline, at 5:30, they travel to Zionsville, and this Friday, they take on St. Joseph at 6. Let's shift gears towards boys lacrosse.
Yeah, they hosted Culver last Saturday, and things did not start well one bit. Culver led 3-1 in the second quarter, but Westfield came right back. A 5-point third quarter propelled the Shamrocks to an 8-5 victory. Sam Myers would have 4 total points with 2 goals and 2 assists in the win.
They competed on Wednesday at Guerin Catholic, and this Saturday they host St. Joseph.
How about the girls? They had a rough one against Noblesville. Here's Callie Stigler for more.
I'm Callie, and we're talking girls lacrosse. They had a 1-point game on Monday versus Heritage. They lost 9-8 to make their record 5-6. On Thursday, they play Park Tudor, who is 6-3. They are ranked 2nd in the 1A sectional 6. Then on Friday, they play Penn, who is 2-7. Looking at their schedule, they have played really tough teams, so you can't just look at their record. They are a very tough team to play. JV on Saturday plays in the Metro Tournament at Brebeuf. And then on Tuesday, both teams are back in action playing Culver. Culver is a very hard team.
Thanks, Callie. Let's move on to volleyball. And your 10-2 Rocks are 110th in the nation.
Yeah, they are outscoring opponents 31-10 all year, and their win over Carmel last Wednesday was huge. A 3-0 victory was sparked by 15 Carlo Hughes-Den kills, and CJ Fox added 9 of his own. Monday, they traveled to Brownsburg. Here is that score. And the next day, they traveled to Zionsville. Here is that score. And this Saturday at 9 a.m., they compete in the Southport Invite. Let's finally wrap up school sports with track and field.
After a long week with some cancellations, they returned to action. Wednesday, the girls competed at the NHS Invite. And this Friday, the boys and girls at the 3-200 distance showcase at 6 p.m.
Yeah, now let's go to national sports. How about the NBA? The Indiana Pacers, finally, first time since 2020, they're back in the playoffs. It feels so good, but they're taking on the Milwaukee Bucks. It's gonna be a rough matchup. Giannis Antetokounmpo might not be 100%. Just what are your expectations for the Pacers going into the playoffs?
Well, thinking about the Pacers, I really think about Tyrese Haliburton, and with Giannis Antetokounmpo not doing completely well right now with his injuries, I'm thinking the Pacers could probably lead on this one.
Yeah, I'm thinking here is if Giannis isn't 100%, you have to just go completely down low,
right,
and abuse the paint.
Mm-hmm.
Miles Turner, he had an incredible game in the game clincher with 31 points. Pascal Siakam, who we got at the trade deadline, hopefully we bring him back.
Mm-hmm.
He was incredible too.
I mean, I'm not also saying that the Bucks don't have any other good players. I'm just saying that, like, with all of our players mostly being in, like, good, you know, none of them are terribly injured that we need. So, and looking at the Bucks, who's, I'd say their best player is injured, it's going to be a rough game for them.
It could be a rough series, especially in the beginning. Damian Lillard and Haliburton, I'm really looking forward to that matchup. They exchanged a few words. These two teams have a lot of bad blood. They fought back in, I forget what month it was. They had a big fight. Giannis, after breaking a franchise record, went into the locker and into like the Pacers tunnel, was demanding the game ball from Oscar Tshiebwe. Malik Beasley, He was talking a whole lot of trash. I'm really looking forward to this matchup, and there may be a couple of fights in there too.
We'll just have to see.
I'll be honest. I don't love a lot of things in this world, but I do love my Indiana Pacers more than a lot of things, and I'm just really excited. And the moment those playoff tickets go on sale, you know where I'll be. Here's Drew Taylor with just a bit of a preview for this matchup.
For the first time since the 2020 bubble season, the Indiana Pacers are in the playoffs. The Pacers will face Milwaukee in the first round of the playoffs, with Game 1 being this Sunday. This Pacers season has been really special. Tyrese Haliburton became an all-star starter, as well as the NBA's leader in assists. The addition of Pascal Siakam, without a doubt, saved the season. Pascal Siakam averaged 22 points per game and helped fuel this Pacers playoff push. The biggest loss of the season, however, was Benedict Mathurin having season-ending knee surgery. In the regular season, the Pacers dominated this what now is starting to feel like a rivalry. The Pacers were 4-1 against the Bucks in the regular season. However, back in January, Bucks guard Malik Beasley stated, I know we're going to play them in the playoffs, and boy, it's not going to be pretty for them. And that's playoff Milwaukee. Giannis has a chip under him. So this all sets up for what should be a very entertaining series. Giannis is doubtful in game one, which gives Indy the edge. Giannis has, without a doubt, dominated Indy all season against the Pacers. He's averaged 42 points per game and 13 rebounds. The Bucks are favored to win this series. However, Stephen A. disagrees and says he thinks the Pacers will bring it home, but I expect this series to be very competitive, to say the least. But in order for the Pacers to bring it home, we're gonna need some big TJ McConnell offense late in each quarter. TJ is a big energy guy that provides a source of fuel for Indiana. Pacers will also have to game plan for how to contain Giannis. I mean, he is the Greek freak. How do you go against that? Also, Halliburton's got to play with the swag he played with in the in-season tournament. But whoever wins this matchup will play the winner of the Knicks versus the 7 seed. That 7 seed is the playoff game tonight, or play-in tournament game tonight between Miami and Philly. But hopefully the Pacers can find their way in this year's playoffs and bring it home for this state. The playoff atmosphere in Gainbridge should be electric because we grow basketball here. Go Pacers.
Yeah, thank you, Drew. Now let's wrap up the show. NFL draft coming up just a couple of weeks away. And I just wanted to ask you, is Caleb Williams to Chicago, do you think it's a done deal?
I think it's a done deal. I mean, I don't think it would have been such a big mention if it wasn't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, especially with the whole Fields trade, I think it made it obvious, but at the same time, Jaden Daniels, I'm really liking him. I think he could be a great prospect, a quarterback. Drake May, but again, Caleb Williams, maybe the most polished of the three.
Yeah.
I would not be shocked if the first three picks were all quarterbacks, because you're looking at Washington, a team that needs a quarterback. Mm-hmm. Sam Howell was just not quite the guy. New England definitely needs a quarterback. And I think Drake May would be a great fit over there.
I agree.
And you're a Dolphins fan. Just what do you think's the biggest team need right now?
Just looking at their season, like 2025, they're obviously going to win the Super Bowl this year. Since they didn't last year, they sold. I'm pretty upset about Christian Wilkins getting traded. That was heartbreaking. But we've kept a lot of our great players. We've gotten a couple of new good ones. I'm not really worried.
I'm a Colts fan. I'm worried. I'll be completely honest with you. DBs, I mean, I think we should have gone for L'Jarius Sneed with that trade, but we let the Titans get him. Come on, man. We got to do better there.
That's crazy.
But, I mean, Kool-Aid McKinstry, pick 15. I'm calling it right there. I think that's who the Colts should go for. Maybe Nate Wiggins, maybe Cooper DeJean, but I just need a DB. And this Colts team, they're in a pretty good position. I heard talk about trading up for Brock Bowers. I'm not loving it. I think Jelani Woods still has potential at tight end.
I think Brock Bowers could actually do pretty well in Colts.
Oh, I think.
I'm thinking.
I think in the red zone, Anthony Richardson, you could just lob it up to Brock Bowers. He's a generational tight end talent. I mean, the last time we talked about a generational tight end talent, we were talking about Kyle Pitts, which did not translate. Which I don't think it's entirely on him,
right.
But maybe Malik Nabers could fall to the Colts, get a good wide receiver there, but I doubt it. He's probably the number two wide out behind Marvin Harrison in this draft. But yeah, I think that's going to do it. Anything left to add?
I don't think so. Let's just stay humble and go Rocks.